G'day all, Mr. Paladin here, and today I want to look at Hat Fortress 2, or hats and trading and what I think about hats in general in Team Fortress 2, and warning, this may contain some violence. I got together my Steam community group and asked them to join an empty server so, you know, we weren't interrupting a public game, and I asked them, you know, bring your hats, bring your favorite miscellaneouses, and just do really derpy stuff, and I'll have a look at the replays. So, just like the start of any game, you often have a look over your team, and you look at the players' hats, you look at their miscellaneouses, and you automatically start judging your teammates. Especially if you're a medic. As a medic, you're probably going to gravitate, like this medic, towards the unusual hat there on the soldier. Or you're probably going to be avoiding the heavy who, you know, has no hat or has his gibbous out. Or likewise, if you're a heavy, you're probably not going to put much faith into your medic who is, you know, just sitting on you with his medi gun and not looking to heal his teammates. Looking around here, we see the engineer on the blue team. He's already managing to build in spawn, so he's got some experience going on. Nice little miscellaneous on his back there. So, you know, yes, I do start judging my teammates based on their gear. But just because somebody has a hat is not an indicator of their skill. Someone without a hat is not necessarily an indicator of their lack of skill. But I guarantee you the people with the hats and the miscellaneous have spent more time in the game. They have been exposed to more experiences, they have been in more situations. So naturally, if I see it, I'm going to expect a more experienced player. And if I see a lack of it, I'll have to look for another indicator, usually the score. If I see someone sneaking up the scoreboard, but I notice they haven't had a hat or a miscellaneous or something going on, then yes, it's got to be a skill factor there. Now, the reason why hats aren't always a clear indicator of skill is I have several people I know who don't play the game very much, but they are very invested in the economy aspect of Team Fortress 2. They are very good traders. They had very little and they kept trading up, and now they've amassed a whole bunch of hats, a whole bunch of gear, and, you know, that's their thing. I, on the other hand, I can't stand trading. I hate trade servers. If I get up a bulk of metal, I'm more likely to latch onto one of my friends who loves trading and say, hey, go ahead and trade this, I'm looking for, you know, and I'll give them a blanket shopping list of what I'm looking for. And I'll often pop them a bit more metal than what it's worth online. Online you'll find spreadsheets that'll give the general trade value of items. But, you know, that's never a clear indicator. You know, stuff is worth what people will pay for it. If somebody's looking for the last item in a set, they're gonna pay more than what it's worth, probably just to get it done fast. Like I just said, I'll pay more metal than what stuff's worth just so I don't have to waste my life in a trade server. Here's another thing. I often wear hats to trick the enemy. I'll often, you'll see in some of my videos, I'm wearing gibbous or I'm wearing the paper hat, just to fool enemies into thinking I'm a bad spy or I'm a bad medic. And they can sometimes catch people by surprise when I do things out of their mindset for a newer player to do. I've also been known to wear my fez or some set items on my hat when I'm not using the set to try and throw off enemies, especially more experienced enemies. Another reason why I don't really trend towards the hats is because I play spy a lot, and a spy, when you're under a disguise just like this guy here, you don't get your hat. You're getting the hat of your disguise. So I'm mindful of the enemy. Sometimes, you know, you'll come up against an enemy who has an unusual hat like this guy, and I don't want to pick his disguise, because if two of you are in the same area, the enemy's gonna pick you out really, really fast. In the later part of this game, you'll see a bit of my backpack, or there is the ability to browse people's backpacks, and you'll see that I really don't have many items. I honestly don't. I'm relatively new to the game when you look at the big scope of things. So I even had the bronze medal. You know how you get the medals, you've probably all got medals. I destroyed my bronze medal way back in the day because I was still free to play and I was starting to run out of space in my backpack. I was still trying to determine if I really wanted to continue playing the game. Here's another thing to consider. Oh, and these poor hatless fools here. I'm sorry. You saw the hatless engineer, the experienced players were easily able to take care of a sentry gun, and that sniper didn't stand a chance, even though the spy decloaked right next to him and bumped him and everything, but the poor hatless fool didn't know any better. So what do you think about set items, guys? I asked the Reddit community a lot of these questions before making this film to get a general sense of what the internet thought. And a lot of the internet thought that, you know, the set hats were fair enough. They're not really an upgrade, they're not really a downgrade. For example, the Fez I'm used to having with the Saharan set, you've got to use a Saharan set. So you're already at a disadvantage of not being able to disguise and having a pretty weak weapon. A lot of the other sets are like that, like the Attendant, where you take extra damage. You know, there's pluses and minuses. Some people seem to think that, you know, the set hats can sometimes exclude players, because, you know, they're hard to gather, so the newer players are going to take a much longer time to get the set together, to understand what the set does. This set on the left is the newer set. The Heatmaker there. And he's not actually hitting those crates, he's shooting over the top of them. Okay, so Valve makes a lot of money on this game. They really do. I was asking the Reddit community how much people were paying in Team Fortress 2 or how much they've paid over their lifetime. And you know, some people have just played the minimum to become premium, some people were still free to play. But several people mentioned they have spent well over $200 on Team Fortress 2. Valve does make money on hats, but you got to compare it to other games like, you know, World of Warcraft. They're making a ton of money on that game. People subscribing to paying a monthly fee. You know, you could put money into keys or into metal or into Manco store items here and not spend as much as you do on World of Warcraft easily. If you want to know how much money Valve is making on this, there's some articles out there online about the Team Fortress 2 economy, and you can easily see the numbers on that. It was a very interesting read. Also, consider that they use Team Fortress 2 to promo other games. There's promo hats available that you can't buy in the Manco store. I've been known to download games to try them, to get the achievements, to get those hats. I mean, I like the little promo hats, I think they're cute. But, you know, I would have never have played the games unless there was a hat for Team Fortress 2. So yeah, Valve admitted that Team Fortress 2 is kind of like a guinea pig for several new ideas they wanted to implement. The item drop system, I think, was the first in Team Fortress 2. The Manco store, linking games like Portal 2 and stuff like that to items in Team Fortress 2. You know, many things were tested in the Team Fortress 2 environment first for Valve, so it's been a good little place for them to try out new stuff. And I think it's been very profitable for them, and profitable for us too. I've got a lot of enjoyment out of the game. If I have to compare how much I've spent in this game, you know, I've probably spent maybe $25. You know, I've purchased a few items, I've purchased some keys, I've traded for items. But over the course of the life of this game, I think they've made more than enough money off this game. It's still interesting, it's still fresh, they're keeping updates. You know, we're about to have the Man vs. Machine update. I couldn't ask for more than that. This has been a pretty great game. Here's another thing to consider with hats. I mean, you're playing a first-person shooter game. You don't actually get to see what you're wearing unless you like do the replays like I'm doing here. And you gotta wonder, why bother with the visual appearance of your character if you don't get to see your character? I mean, it's a fair question. A lot of role-playing games and stuff, you get to have your character front and center on the screen. But in Team Fortress 2, no, you only see yourself in replays and stuff. So really, you're dressing up for other people, which is odd. So I don't know if it's just a vanity thing. You know, let me know in your comments why you wear the hats that you do. Are you doing it for strategic reasons? Are you doing it for set bonuses? Do you just like the certain look of things? You know, what is it? And again, this is a lot of my Steam community in this game, and I repeated this bit because I wanted to get a different angle. So if you see something particularly derpy in here and you want to know what in the world people were doing, you know, let us know. Tag the film and put it in the comments and we'll try to explain what's going on here. I'll provide links to the Steam community groups down in the comments section. I'm also going to be planning on doing Facebook and Twitter. You guys have forced me to throw up a Facebook and a Twitter and try and be a bit more social than what I've been. I'm already pretty social on the Reddit community. I'll put a link for Reddit down in the comments as well. There's a lot of good information there. I'm getting a lot of good feedback on what people are thinking about the man versus machine update that's coming. A little bit of quick fix there, jumping around. Oh, that was a bit of a fail. It's looking good right up until the point where everyone died. So yeah, as a medic, I'm definitely looking for players with more experience. I'm wanting to have guys who turn around and make sure they heal me. I mean, not heal me, I'm sorry. Turn around and watch my back as I heal them. I want people who are spy aware. And, you know, hats won't actually do that, but... Oh, poor spy crab. Hats won't do that, but it's a pretty good indicator that somebody is gonna be watching their back. They've got a bit of experience. And if it's not the hat, I often join a game, especially a game mid-progress, and I will look at the score. Especially if I notice the score on the enemy team, the top scorer is a spy, you know, I'll join the game and I'll switch straight onto Pyro and start watching out for him because, you know, the team is obviously not very spy aware for the enemy spy to have scored up so much. So, you know, Pyro's an easy bet against the spy. Even an experienced spy, or I play spy a lot so I know what to look for, so experienced spies can even have a hard time getting past. Little bit of spy crab action here. Don't hurt the spy crab, no, no! Oh, he survived. Oh look, he might have found a mate. Oh, afraid not. Hats can also be crafted. I don't know how many people tend to craft hats. They can be done with a bit of metal, and since, you know, you get the weapons for free, you get metal from the weapons, the hats are free. If you just keep playing the game, you'll eventually amass enough items to be able to get up more than enough metal for several hats. And you can either go into trade servers or get with your friends and trade the metal for the miscellaneous items or the weapons you don't have, because metal's a pretty good commodity. Eventually people start trading up to different hats, you know, different miscellaneouses, really rare hats, strange hats, earbuds are actually a thing. You know, they're very expensive in-game, so it's a bit of prestige. People like to have them. I don't think much of them myself, but, you know, I think they're cute. Going back to the amount of money people have spent on the game, you know, how much money have you spent? I actually don't mind people spending a bit of money. Like I mentioned before, you know, you've got games like World of Warcraft where people spend monthly amounts on that. Or I like to compare Team Fortress 2 to several things in the entertainment industry. For example, a good night out at the movie. If you're just by yourself and you don't buy too many concessions, what are you spending, like 25 bucks? You know, so one movie a month, $25 in the Manco store, I'm going to get more hours of gameplay in a month from Team Fortress 2, a lot more entertainment value for me, than going to the movies on a regular basis. Quite easily. You know, the amount of hours I've spent on Team Fortress 2, I can't even count anymore because I've reset my stats more than once. I kind of did a stat reset back when, you know, I had just gotten out of what I'd call myself the newbie stage. And then when I started to do the YouTube stuff, I reset my scores again. So if you're looking at my Steam pages, you're probably not getting a full indicator of what I've spent on each of the classes because I've done that reset. But how many hours have you spent on Team Fortress 2? Has it been worth your entertainment dollar? I mean, you didn't even have to pay for the game. You could still be free to play and still be enjoying the game. You might be having some trouble with your backpack, but you know, that's a thing you gotta do. You could choose just to spend $5 on the game, get a premium account. If you're doing that, I recommend spending a few of those, especially early on the class packs, where you can just get a few of the weapons unlocks real quick. They're 99 cents each at the Manco store. You even get a couple of little hats with them. But I also don't recommend, if you're just joining or you're new to the game, don't start trading straight away. People can take advantage of you. This is the internet. You do have to be careful of what you trade, what you buy and sell when you first come free to play. I mean, when you first come premium from free to play. You know, it's a dangerous world out there. You gotta watch yourself. Check online. There are the spreadsheets of the prices. You can find those pretty easily. Just go to Google and have a look around. Just make sure you're not getting gypped before you make that trade. I don't mind paying a little bit more, and you might not mind paying a little bit more, but getting absolutely ripped for an item is not cool at all. Heavy's out of ammunition here. Oh, poor guy. Oh, there's our spy crab again. Oh, and he gets knocked up. A knocked up spy crab. Oh no! How could he? How are we gonna get young spy crabs if you keep killing the knocked up spies? And, you know, this soldier has a bit of experience here. He's shooting from a very protected location and pretty much takes out the enemy team. Even though people are being derpy in this round, there's still a good display of skill every now and then. I encourage you to look back and look at all the action here. There's really more than what I could capture. There's a lot of interesting stuff going on. Right here I was getting spore camped. Had it coming out with my dead ringer, but the Pyro didn't notice I had gotten past. Heavy went for a sandwich and the scout got him. And the team can move out. You've seen my spawn camping video, guys. I mean, spawn camps, I don't think they're a problem. You just gotta deal with it. Roll with the punches. Know what the enemy's doing. Use that experience. Just don't be too upset about what happens. Really. I don't know. I don't get angry at people who get all ragey in the games, because I understand, you know, you're investing time, you're investing your entertainment time, you could be doing other things, and you really don't want to be wasted by some random person on the internet who you don't know, who you're probably never going to see again. But rather than get mad, I try and help people out, but sometimes people are just there to troll, or they're there to just ruin other people's fun. And that's no fun at all. It's not fun for anyone. Heavy, how could you? Oh, you have no hat, that's why. Killing spy crabs. So yeah, be sure and join my Steam community group, because my friends list, you know, it's getting really full. I can't keep adding everyone, but by joining the Steam community group, you'll get in on things like this, where I go to look for footage. I'm going to be looking for actors for spy crab adventures and stuff like that. you know, just funny stuff. So I'd love to have you aboard. I'd like to hear your thoughts on the video. That's why I'm going to be doing the Facebook and the Twitter and stuff like that. You'll see the links down below once I get them. Nice bit of medic work here. Very nicely done. And you know, I also encourage people, especially if they're new to the game, you know, the vanilla sets are all good. You don't need extra unlocks. But if something kills you and you're not sure why, push F6, take the replay if you're on a replay server, and I encourage you to have a good look around, like in this video, and find out what went on. Find out what killed you. You go, little spy crab, you go. Okay, well that's enough of the derpiness. I want to actually look a little bit at crafting. Crafting metal. If you use the menu options to actually smelt class items, it's not as good as coming into custom blueprint, and you can see your entire backpack here. You'll see I've got duplicates of some items here. If I select it from here and just select those two items on the custom blueprint, I can still craft the metal. And that's a lot easier than the menus you have to navigate on the smelting class items. Right below smelt class weapons and items, you can combine the scrap metal. And you see, I've finally gathered up enough metal. I'm actually going to craft a hat today. I've been wanting to do it for a long time, but I've kept using my metal for other stuff. But I've got some haunted Halloween metal. And I've got enough scrap metal now that I can craft the Halloween hat, and I'm really hoping for the skull. So here we go. Let's go to the special. Fabricate haunted headgear. Throw in all my metal here. And you know, this is fun. I know it's probably costing me more metal. I could probably trade for all sorts of hats. But I've wanted to use this unusual haunted metal scrap ever since I got it. It's one of the earliest things I got in the game. Yeah, I know, it's because of the haunted metal. Crafting succeeded. Excellent. Spine-tingling skull. I've wanted this one. So let's go check it out. You see, I'm wearing my gibbous here. Well, I can't use the skull because I'm wearing the professor's specs. I've got to drop that. And now it becomes available. No, doesn't that look good? I like it. I can use it on a couple of different classes. I don't have to just keep it on my spy. Let's see, so I'll sort my backpack here, and I want to show you something different. Even experienced players tend not to know this. You can actually change the style of a gibbous if you've got more than one style. Just select the hat and go to set style. The set style button becomes available, and you can switch it up. I've known a lot of experienced players who did not know this. It can't happen with every hat. You'll see these other hats don't have a set style. There are some other hats out there, I'd have to check the wiki. But thanks for watching, this was Hat Fortress 2. Big shoutouts from Reddit, and big shoutouts from the video. A lot of these guys are in my Steam community group. Please join the group, and check the links down in the comments below.